Hello and welcome. You're watching the Budget of Hope on ICICIdirect.com, and with me two noted tax practitioners in the country, P.S. Krishnan, partner at Grant Thornton Bharat LLP. He's an indirect tax expert. Also with us today, Amit Kedia. He's a chartered accountant based out of Mumbai, and he specializes in direct taxes. Welcome to this conversation to go through what seems to have been a budget of hope, at least for the stock markets, Amit and Mr. Krishnan. So what we'll do is to keep it very simple, and I'm going to start with you, Amit, first, and try and get the top two takeaways, the good and the bad, from the direct tax front as far as this budget is concerned. Keep it short so that we can cover as much ground as is possible.
Yes, so thank you so much, Siddharth. So I would say that I think given the pandemic that we had last year, it's continuing this year as well. The expectations were quite low from the finance minister that she will be able to do too many reforms. In fact, the fear was there that there could be some new taxes which may be levied on corporates, could be in the form of COVID cess, or could be an increase in capital gains tax or tinkering with STT. To the relief of all, I think there were no increase in any taxes or any new taxes being levied.
Right.
Because of which I think there were hardly any negatives, I would say. And it was more like a positive approach. I think the body language of the finance minister, the policy announcements which she made, I think were pretty well accepted and taken by everybody, including the stock markets. And I think the stock market gave a very large green salute to the budget, which all of us has seen during the day. In terms of so positives, as I said, no negatives has been the positives. But I'll put it this way, that there have been few remarkable changes or...
And what's bad? What's wrong?
Yeah, in terms of, it's very difficult to in fact find anything wrong in this. As I said, the expectations were so low. But I'll put it this way, that there would be a couple of things where, individuals could now be taxed on, say, example, there is some interest on EPF or PPF, which accrues on a contribution made more than 2.5 lakh rupees, or in terms of ULIP policies, where the contribution is made to ULIP policies for more than 2.5 lakhs, again, the accrual there could now be taxed at the time of redemption of those policies. So small negatives for some individual high net worth taxpayers, I would say. But I think that's probably par for the course.
Okay. Mr. Krishnan, I'm going to reverse the order and ask you a question about the announcement that certain GST exemptions will be taken away. You must have had occasion to go through the fine print. Is there anything in the finance bill which gives us clarity, or do we need to wait for a GST council meeting to get more details on that? And then I will ask you about the overall indirect tax framework, if you could answer the first question.
There's actually, Siddharth, I think it was the customs exemption she was mentioning. On GST exemptions, there was not much of a mention. It was the customs exemption, okay, which she said will be phased out, and they are going to rationalize the customs duty structure. From October, there will be a new structure, close to 4. Last year, around 80 notifications were reviewed. This year, they have began the exercise for review of 400 exemption notifications under customs. Therefore, it is the customs exemptions that are going to be taken away. And on GST, I didn't see anything relative to the exemptions.
I'm glad I asked. I was under the impression that there has been some GST related announcement. It's customs, and viewers, all of you know this. Krishnan, the second part of my question, from your indirect tax practice perspective, what is the highlight, and is there a negative that you have spotted?
See, I will tell you three highlights. The number one highlight is she has really supported the domestic industry by reducing a lot of on lot of products there has been a reduction in the tax structure, particularly on the raw materials for iron and steel, steel scrap, copper scrap, for the metal sector, and on textiles also some of the products. Plus on lot of the final products like PCBs for mobile chargers and adapters, and also on leather products and plastic products, there has been an increase in the rate structure. This is basically to help the domestic industry. That is in line with the Make in India initiative that the government has been pushing for the past 3-4 years. The other important factor is, though there has been an agri infrastructure that has been imposed on many products, particularly on petrol and diesel, gold. On gold and silver, there has been an overall duty reduction, and on petrol and diesel, the rates have been neutralized by reducing the central margin of tax. She has not touched the state margin, but on central margin, it has been reduced. Therefore, the tax structure on petrol and diesel remains the same. Therefore, it will not pave way for inflation. So that is another positive. And on the GST front, though as a practitioner and as a chartered accountant, we would all have expected the GST audit certification to continue. There has been a announcement that the certification for the independent auditor will be taken away, but there is going to be a self-certification that is going to continue. So these are the three highlights that come to my mind. And on the negative side,
hold on, because I need to interrupt you here and ask you about something that's already being debated, which is the agri-infra cess. Number one, any cess collected by the union only goes into the union account. That is pretty clear. What is the likely revenue impact of the agri-infra cess? And number two, have you done any calculation about the reduction in the special excise duty and the basic duty on petroleum and diesel? Can you please explain this in the simplest possible terms? Because this concerns a lot of consumers and not just companies.
So, Siddharth, I cannot give you the numbers right away because the time has been too short to work out on the numbers. But what I can say is the consumer is not going to pay much in terms of taxes on petrol and diesel because of the neutralization of the taxes there. While there has been a reduction in the basic excise duty and the special additional excise duty, there has been an agri-infra cess that has been imposed. That is specific mobilized funds towards agriculture infrastructure, where even yesterday the PM had told that he wanted to corporatize agriculture in India. Therefore, towards that, there has been a cess that has been imposed. But the common man is not going to pay anything additional in terms of the taxes. Therefore, there should not be an increase in the petrol.
You were mentioning, increase in petrol and diesel prices. And so far, we haven't heard that. You were mentioning a negative. Please mention it quickly. And then I go back to direct taxes in the time that we have left with us. With
one negative that I saw from the budget was there was no specific announcement on the merchandise export incentive scheme, which has been stopped, and many of the exporters have not received any of the incentives for lack of funds right from April 20. And also on the RODTEP, there is no, though RODTEP has been implemented from January 1st, there was no definite time plan on when the rates are going to be announced and how it is going to move. So there is no allocation also seen there. So that is something which the export fraternity was expecting, and it has not come up.
Amit, one of the key things really that we have seen in terms of the general chatter around today's budget has been the fact that a lot of people are saying, dekhiye, annadata ke liye kar rahe hain, baki sectors ke liye kar rahe hain, but tax data ke liye kya hua? Why wasn't there a large giveaway, for example, on the personal income tax front, or for example, medical allowance, that limit being enhanced considering the pandemic? How would you respond to the general and the specific proposals on the direct tax front that you have seen in the budget?
Sure. So I'll reply this in two parts. One is in terms of the situation where we are in, the fisc, the country is in. I think to expect that there will be too many giveaways by the government in terms of tax rebates, etc. was little, you know, low on the agenda of the government, and the expectations, you know, should have been little lower. And hence, I think to that extent, no reduction in taxation were also seen to be a welcome move. As I was mentioning earlier in the conversation, that the fear was that there could be certain increase in the tax rate, which didn't come, and hence there was a big relief, across the board by most of the taxpayers, corporates, as well as the equity markets. So that's on that. Number two is that in terms of the direct tax code and the why direct tax code was required at first place in last decade. Was the consistency of the government policies, not tinkering of the tax rates, etc. So certainty for all investors as well as corporates and the government. I think that is an important thing, in which I think this budget has shown that the government knows that it should not be tinkering too much with the tax rates, etc. And which is a good sign, a majority sign, I would say. And I think again, everybody's welcome that move. Of no changes in the tax laws.
Mr. Krishnan, last comment, really quick comment on anything that you might want to add in terms of the overall tax strategy in this budget.
Siddharth, I felt that this year, even though there was a lot of hype around the media suggesting a lot of changes, I honestly felt that the finance minister has little to tinker in terms of give away to the people, both on the direct tax and indirect tax front, what with the fiscal deficit at around 9.5%, which honestly they admitted also. It was even being welcomed by many people without fudging the figures or without going into trying to make it look better.
Absolutely.
That was accepted. Therefore, I felt this is a budget.
I completely agree, Mr. Krishnan. I think that is a great point to end today's conversation on, although that is an expenditure side issue and to be discussing that with tax professionals like you. But if you spend less as the government, then perhaps the government will tax you less. I think we should take comfort from that fact. And I absolutely agree. The complete transparency on the expenditure side is perhaps something that has come as a welcome surprise after years and years that we have seen in previous governments of under the line budgeting, which was a completely creative term, Indian Jugaad really. So I would say that it's been a brilliant part of the budget, and hopefully we will see that the government, as the economy improves, as buoyancy returns, may consider doing something just like it did that September when it cut the corporate income tax rate. So with that hope, I'm going to thank you, Amit Kedia and P.S. Krishnan, for your time today with us. And you, the viewer, if you've been catching the thoughts of these two tax experts, you will realize that perhaps the relief in the markets and the general economy on the taxation side is well placed. Once again, thank you very much for this conversation. With that, it's a wrap on this conversation. Goodbye.